Hello everyone. As part of a series of videos, video lectures on rock mechanics and starter control, in this video lecture I'm going to cover the topics pertaining to chapter 4, which is chapter 4, and this is second part of chapter 4. And before I move on, let's recap what we discussed in the earlier last video lecture. Okay. In the last video, we had discussed about rock quality designation, RQD, and formula used to determine value of RQD for a given like borehole sample, like how to calculate the value of RQD, rock quality designation. And we also solved some couple of numerical problems on RQD. Then we discussed like based on the what are the computed values of RQD, based on the percentage of RQD, how to classify the rock samples, whether they are very good, fair, poor, very poor, like what exactly the criteria, like in what range if the value of RQD lies, then what would be the corresponding description of it. That we discussed in the earlier video lecture. Then we also discussed this the starting few topics of the chapter 4, like the stress measuring devices. Okay, how the like what are the various devices that are used to measure the stresses in situ condition, like in the field itself, in the in situ condition, how to measure the in situ stresses. Like there are three different methods that we'll be using to measure the in situ state of stresses. One is a flat jack method of measuring in situ stress. Flat jack method, this is also known as a stress restoration method. In this method, just to reiterate, right, or just to recap, basically what we did is actually on the face, we have marked 2 points by means of pins, and the distance between them is being measured very accurately. And a slot is being driven between these 2 points up to certain extent and a certain depth. Then the flat jack, due to the drivage of the slot between the 2 points, let us say P and Q, the distance earlier, what is the distance that were present between, that was measured accurately between P and Q, those 2 points, it gets decreases because due to what you call the disturbance in the in situ state of stresses, it always try to close the opening and it will try to get redistributed and always tries to close the opening, which results into reduction in the what you call the distance between the 2 points. Okay, so then what we did as part of this experiment, we have placed the flat jack into the slotted into the slot, and we then using hydraulically operated pump, we have increased hydraulic pressure. The hydraulic pressure is applied on the flat jack in such a way that the distance between the 2 points measured, it must be same as that of the original distance that we have measured. So like unless until it reaches the original distance between the 2 points reaches to the original one, till that extent we need to apply the hydraulic pressure. Okay, the pressure at which the points distance between those two measuring points become same as that of the original distance, that pressure is known as the in situ pressure. Then we discussed about the what you call overcurrent technique. This is also known as the stress relief method. It is also known as stress relief method. And the last one which we discussed was what hydraulic fracturing method. This method is being used to measure the stress at a very greater depth. In this method, basically the hydraulic pockets are placed at a location which are separated by a distance of 1 meter, and those the locations where the in situ stress we need to measure, they will be isolated, and the hydraulic pressure will be supplied. Supplied to the required pockets where we need to measure the in situ state of stress. The hydraulic pressure will be we will keep on increasing the hydraulic pressure at the required pockets till the surrounding rock mass gets fractured. So the pressure at which the pressure in the hydraulic pocket in the pockets at which the surrounding rock mass gets fractured is a measure of in situ stress. This is what exactly the principle behind the hydraulic fracturing method. Okay, let's move on to the actual topic. Okay, as part of this video lecture, these are the topics which I am going to cover. Like it's what you call a measurement of deformation of strata. like we'll discuss elaborately, like okay, what exactly the deformation is, and how the deformation is being produced in whenever we make an excavation. Then like what are the tools, what are the different devices that we'll be using for the measurement of deformation of the strata. Like one is a remote convergence indicator, second one is this is also known as RCI, and the second one is the telltale borehole extensiometer. This is the one which most widely used in most of the coal mines, underground coal mines. Next, magnetic ring multipoint borehole extensiometer. So these are all the different deformation measuring devices that will be used, that we'll be using in underground mines. Okay, so the deformation, basically how the deformation is produced in a strata, while carrying out the mining activity. If you understand that concept, then it will be like, then how to control that particular deformation so as to carry out the mining activity in an effective and safe manner. So let us see like how exactly the deformation is being produced in a rock mass. See, look at here, before making the opening, these topics, these points which I already discussed in earlier video lecture, I just wanted to repeat the same concepts again here, so that it will be a continuation while discussing the various devices that are used to measure the deformation in the rock mass. Okay, if you look at this diagram, the stress distribution around a narrow opening, okay, in case of before making any opening in its in situ condition, what are the stresses that were acting in the 3D block of rock mass? They are in equilibrium. Let us say, if you look at this diagram, like there are three different forces, P1, P2, P3, which are acting in this block of rock mass, and with the before making the opening, they are in equilibrium. So till this point, there is no problem because we are not as deep, and whatever the insertive way it is present as it is, it is in equilibrium state. But due to mining activity, what are the forces which were in equilibrium earlier? They get redistributed. It is something like, look at here. It was like, earlier this force was like this. Remember, right? It was before making, it's all in, it was in in situ condition. And it was like this. This is how it was. Now, I made this opening now. Like the opening is something like this. Look at here. If you choose a different color, yep. This is the opening I made. Okay. Due to this, whatever the opening, narrow opening which I made, earlier whatever the forces that were in equilibrium, they gets what? Redistributed. They'll try to choose a location there, it may get redistribute that particular load. So this arches, whatever the arches which you are seeing, the forces which was which were acting in vertical, now they get redistributed onto the sides of the opening and the or onto the edges of the opening, right? So as a result, what happens? The load which is due to redistribution of the forces, but the load which is acting on the edges of the opening, this portion, this portion. Look at here. This part and this part. This bulged portion that you are seeing, right? This portion. This is called abutment pressure. This is known as what? Abutment pressure. Abutment. This is abutment pressure now. Okay? This is how it is going to be. Now what happens, right? Now whatever the forces which are acting vertically downwards, they get redistributed, fine. But up to what extent it's get redistributed? So the forces which are acting vertically downwards, it won't get redistributed to the full extent. Like 100% force won't get redistributed now, only certain portion. Still some portion is left, some portion which was acting vertically downwards, still gets this portion, right? It still gets what acting on the, see, this is how it got redistributed, but this portion will be still acting. This is the redistributed part of it, the diagram which I'm drawing it. It's a distributed one. Right? Now, the force, the one which is present here, this will be still acting on it. So whatever the layers that were present in the overlying strata, like vertical, they are subjected to some kind of moment. That moment is called the lateral forces, guys. See, look at this. This P2, this one, this one, this one. These are the lateral forces. So this movement of lateral forces takes place. The, due to this moment of lateral force, the lateral forces which were acting, there will be a, what you call the induced stress. Induced stress is nothing but due to the, what you call the redistribution, the some disturbance, whatever the, what you call, earlier there was like no movement along that direction, but it got induced due to the lateral movement of the strata. So these stresses are called induced stresses. So these induced stresses will cause some disturbance between the layers of the strata, or the separation between the layers of the strata. That's what it is. The previous, if you look at right in the previous video lecture, I have elaborately explained this concept here. Once I am just to, in continuation to that, and you know, I am trying to explain it again here. But see, these are all the different what you call separation between the layers of the strata. It is due to what? This lateral movement or the induced stresses, right? So this separation, this movement, we need to measure between the layers of the strata. Sometimes what happens, it is if the, see here, it is trying to close the opening. There's nothing but there will be sag. There will be sag. Am I right? Look at here. There is a, we chose something different color. Yeah. This. There will be sag. There will be sag. This is nothing but what? The convergence of the opening. Am I right? This is called the, because whatever the height of the opening that we are having, it's get what converged. There is a some kind of sag. So this convergence of this opening we need to measure. How much is the sag? How much it is, how exactly the overlying strata is behaving? Okay, this we need to measure. Not only that, if there is a movement of the strata, what would be the separation between the layers of the strata? How exactly it is going to behave? That also we need to measure. For that purpose, we'll be using the deformation measuring instruments. Hope you guys got it. For that purpose, we'll be measuring the deformation, we'll be using the deformation measuring instruments. Okay, so let us clear this. Hope you guys got it. Now there will be a closure. Okay, this is nothing but the convergence I'm talking about and the deformation. Okay, so let's see. Okay, so this basically represents what in this figure? P is the bending forces. And P2 is the lateral forces, intensity of which increases with the depth. S is the shear force. And P1 is the vertical forces. And C is the what increases the pressure on the roadway. This is known as what? Abutment pressure. Okay, here. Yeah. This is the abutment pressure, right? B is the bending force. This is the shear force, and P1 is the vertical forces, and P2 is the lateral forces. Am I right? So that's what it is. So based on this, so in order to overcome the problems, the strata control problems that generally we might face, okay, during due course of time while carrying out the mining activity, okay, for effectively strata controlling the behavior of the strata, we need to measure the corresponding displacement or the corresponding moments between the layers of the strata. So for that purpose, we'll be using this. Okay, this is all the vertical different notation that we used in the diagram. Okay, B1, B is the bending, P2 is the lateral, S is the shear forces, and P1 is the vertical force, and C is the vertical abutment pressure. Next one, the measurement of induced stress. What is the induced stress now? It is due to what they call the redistribution of the forces. There will be deformation, right? There will be lateral forces. So measurement of induced stress, nothing but the lateral stresses, are the deformation or deformation measuring devices. That's what it is. So we need to, let us, instead of induced stress, we'll call it as deformation measuring devices. That's better. Okay, let me put it. Measurement of deformation measuring devices. Okay, what exactly it is? See, due to mining activity, the institute stresses which are in equilibrium gets redistributed. The same thing which I discussed, which I explained in a few minutes back, like gets redistributed. As a result, there will be a deformation between the layers of the strata. Okay, the strata deformation in the overlying layers of the strata and the closure of the mine openings is measured by the following method. As I said, right? Because there will be a sag. And which trying to close this opening, right? So this is called the convergence of the roof, am I right? So we need to measure that. And the deformation between the layers, this we need to measure that, right? How to measure that? Okay, that's what exactly we were talking. So the strata deformation in the overlying layers of the strata and the closure of the mine opening is measured by the following methods. One is remote convergence recorder. This is nothing but this is basically remotely I can measure. I mean, by keeping that instrument somewhere, you know, like I can measure in a remote location, what would be the, what you call the behavior of the strata? Is there any sag in the, what you call the, whatever the layer or strata that is present above the opening? Okay. Whether what you call any, there is a possibility any closure of that particular opening. Okay. That we need to measure. Or whether there will be any, what you call the convergence of the roof, right? So that we need to measure. For that purpose, we'll be using in any remote location. It's not the remote operated, guys. It is a in a remote location. If you want to measure the convergence of a roof, then for that purpose, we'll be using remote convergence recorder. So let us discuss the various deformation devices that are used to measure the deformation of the overlying strata. One is the remote convergence recorder. Second one is telltale borehole extension meter. This is the one which is being used most widely in underground coal mines. Okay. Next, magnetic ring multi-point borehole extension meter. It has got its own significance actually, but it is not that popular as when compared to the other two devices or other two equipments. Okay. So let us discuss further. Let's move on. This is a remote convergence recorder. Look at here. It basically measures the deformation of the roof. What exactly it does now? Look at here. Just a minute. Let me draw the diagram, annotate. Look at this here. Let me draw some kind of, let us say this is the opening. Okay. Now, what it does now? This will be measured. This is used to measure. What do you call the convergence between the roof and floor due to this overlying strata. Like this, you have different strata, right? Different layers of the strata. Because of this, is there any convergence of the roof? So if there is a convergence, right? How exactly it is? So it is going to take place like this, right? There will be deformation, right? So this is the convergence of this one. So that is being measured by using the convergence recorder. So look at here. Let me do this. Okay. So what it consists? It consists of a telescopic kind of thing. Two things. Look at here. Telescope means what? One tube will move inside another one. This is a kind of telescopic tube, I can say, right? And this is being anchored at the roof, and this is being anchored there. The other end is being anchored onto the floor. Right? This telescopic, right? So this is being the internal telescopic tube that is being attached by means of a sensor using a spring kind of thing. Okay. So if you look at this one, the principle of operation of this remote convergence recorder or remote convergence indicator, right? Okay, let me cut this. The convergence indicator. Instead of recorder, let us say. RCI. No. So this is a remote convergence indicator. So it consists of, as I said, it consists of two telescopes. It consists of what? Two telescopes. Okay, one will move inside another. And that, the, if you look at it, the top portion, it is being anchored into the roof. And the bottom portion of it, it is being anchored to the floor. Anchored into the floor. Next one, these two telescopes are attached. Okay, the our inner one and the outer one, right? These two are attached by means of a sensor. Okay, this is an adjustable one using which, you know, you can raise the telescope and, you know, you can lower it. This is a kind of adjustable kind of thing. This is the adjustment point. And there will be a sensor. And this inner tube is attached to the, what you call the outer one, outer telescope kind of thing here, by means of a spring. Okay, the spring will be having what? Some kind of what you call coefficient of stiffness. Okay, if there is a deformation, what happens? It will press like this towards inside. Okay, here, let me show you. Okay. See, in case of deformation, what it does now? There will be a force which will be acting like this, right? So, which will press this one towards inside. That is nothing but there will be a change in spring stiffness constant, am I right? See here, there is a formula, if you remember in physics, right? F is equal to kx square. Okay. F is equal to k into x, sorry. Force in the string, F is equal to some stiffness constant into its deformation, x. This is x. So F is equal to k into x. So negative sign indicates what? If there is a compression, it indicates the negative sign of it. F is equal to k into x. The same formula is being used here. So in case of any deformation, due to the deformation, it will come trying to come this. The load will be acting, what call the outer telescope, okay, the tube will be subjected to some kind of compression. Okay, when it is something, it is trying to move what you call move inside of the outer telescope, right? The outer what you call the enclosure. Okay, so since these two are attached by means of a, what you call the spring, right? There will be this is subject, there is a sensor, and the spring will be subject to some kind of compressive forces. So how much is the change in stiffness constant, the k of the spring, and how much would be the, what you call the corresponding deformation, based on these two parameters? It automatically calibrated. This instrument is automatically calibrated. And that information will be passed on to this readout unit. Okay. This from this readout unit, it displays how much is the convergence of the roof in this particular location. So this is how exactly its principle of working. Okay, I repeat here. Look at here. This is basically used. Let me clear all words and let me read it. This is very, very, very important. Okay, remote convergence indicator, RCI. So it is basically used to measure the deformation of the overlying strata in a remote location. Okay, means where the mining activity is being carried out and it is not active, which is a kind of remote location, still you wanted to find out how exactly the movement of the strata or how exactly the strata behaving in that particular location. Now this particular instrument is being attached to the roof and floor at a given point. These are all called the anchoring points. It is attached to the, what you call the roof, inside the roof as well as into the floor. Next, it consists of two what you call the telescopic kind of thing, two tubes. One is the outer tube and second one is the inner tube. In the outer tube, the inner tube will move inside of outer tube. This is the outer one and this is the inner one. Okay, this is a kind of adjustable so that, you know, like you can raise this what you call inner telescope so as to fit it to the exact height of the roadway, right? If the roadway is of having a greater height, then we need to raise this one, right? And it has to be adjusted accordingly. So for that adjustment purpose, this the inner telescopic tube can be lowered or raised by using this adjustment. Next, the inner and outer telescopes are attached by means of a sensor and followed by a, what you call the spring. The spring will be having, whatever the spring, connecting spring that is having, that will be having some stiffness constant that is called K. So the force that is acting, that is being what do you call, look at here, the force that is acting due to this one, due to what you call the compression of the spring, okay, it is mainly due to what, the convergence, in case any convergence of the room, there will be a vertical compression in the spring, right? So that is being measured by means of F is equal to minus K into X. K is the stiffness contest and X is the deformation in the spring. So that will be a vertical calibrated and vertical, and it will be a vertical of transformed to the readout unit, and this readout unit internally calibrates, it takes those reading, that particular information, and it will display the vertical reading in a user readable format or in a user understandable format. When it is there, directly, it will show the how much will be the vertical the deformation at this deformation of the roof or deformation of the overlying strata at this particular location. This is what exactly it's a principle of working of remote convergence indicator. Okay, so let's move on. Look at here, remote convergence indicator. The roof to floor convergence was measured. Convergence was measured with the help of remote type convergence indicator, RCI. The RCI is designed to monitor the relative deformation or movement of rock by measuring the contraction and elongation between the two fixed points. Right? So two fixed points. Next, the RCI consists of remote convergence indicator consists of two telescopic tubes, okay, whose ends are normally fixed in the roof and the floor. So that is what we discussed. Okay, so it consists of two telescopic tubes whose ends are normally fixed in the roof and floor. It has potentiometer connected to the top sliding tube, that is nothing but inner tube, and a slider fixed to the bottom tube so that it won't move. Next, due to movement of the roof, the slider moves on the resistance coil. There is nothing but there is a spring, resulting in change in the resistance, which is directly proportional to the amount of convergence or the divergence. The change in resistance is measured with the help of the battery operated readout unit. So this is what exactly the principle of working of the remote convergence indicator. So next one, this is a more what you call the widely and extensively used device in underground coal mines is telltale borehole extensometer. Okay, so this is basically used to measure what you call the deformation between the layers of overlying strata. How exactly the overlying strata is behaving due to this mining activity. Okay, it consists of a number of spring anchors. So these anchors will be placed at a different locations, and these are the spring anchors, and each anchor is connected to a measuring what you call the scale that has been provided at the other end of it. Okay, this color indicates what at which portion of the anchor it is being connected, and there will be a corresponding change or the deformation between the layers. So let us say in this case there are four anchors, so four what you call the corresponding readout units, which are demarcated by different colors. Okay, let us see. So telltale borehole extensometer, this is a general purpose four wire extensometer incorporating, okay, a water diverting feature and easily readable visual indicator pasted on a small metal rod. This system is designed for installation in a vertical hub. Yes, in order to install this one, right, look at here, a vertical hole is being drilled into the roof, and at different locations these anchors will be placed. Using a metallic rod, these anchors will be released, because the metallic rod will be having what is corresponding scale, so we'll be knowing at what depth we have placed each anchor, and at the other end of the vertical, the end of the anchor is connected to the corresponding what readout unit or the measuring scale unit. And each readout, each vertical anchor is being vertical demarcated with a different color, because in case of any deformation in a particular location, okay, by seeing the reading, by identifying the color and the corresponding change in the reading, we can find out, okay, at what location there is a possibility of deformation between the layers of the strata. Okay, Okay, this is how easily we can predict this one. Look at here. The system is designed for installation in vertical up holes. It consists of four ring anchors, steel wires, four position indicators, and a ref. Four ring spring anchors, steel wires. Each one is having connected to a steel wire. Four position indicators and a reference tube. Middle it contains there is the reference tube. The tension to the wire is provided by the weight of the indicator. Whatever the indicator that is attached at the bottom. The anchors are fixed inside the borehole of 43 mm diameter. So the diameter of the borehole that is being drilled into the roof is, it is of how much? 43 mm. And at diameter, at different horizons, nothing but at different locations, namely let us say 1 meter, 2 meter, 4 meter and 6 meter. I wanted to use them as an anchor point. Okay, so I can drill a hole and you know wherever I want it, I can keep vertical these anchor points. Okay, next, the indicators are 150 mm length. They are graduated in millimeters or centimeters because they are the one which precisely gives the information. Like in case of any deformation between the layers of the strata, okay, like in the respective indicator, it will show the reading. Okay, next, after inserting the anchors, the free end of wire is passed through the reference tube and crimped to the indicator. That's what it is. So the simple one is this one, right? Free end of the wires and they're attached to the this one, reference tube. Okay. So basically these indicators which are present in telltale borehole extension meter. So the indicators which are part of telltale borehole extension meter, they are used to measure the deformation in millimeters as well as centimeters. Okay, after inserting the anchors, because at various locations, you know, we'll be inserting the spring anchors. So after inserting the anchors, the free end of the wire, is passed through the reference tube and crimped to the indicators. So that's what it is. So crimped into this indicator. This is where it is being tightened. Okay. In case of any deformation, right? So by using this color coding, okay, we'll be color coding of respecting anchor. We can find out like, okay, in case of any deformation or the changing the reading of the scale, okay, we can easily find out, okay, at what location there is a deformation between the layers of the strata. So that's what it is. Next one. This is about the remote conversion. Okay. Next, after inserting the anchors, yeah, this is where it is crimped to the indicators. Next, the scale on each indicator is visually read against the bottom reference tube to record the amount of delimitation. Means up to what accuracy we can measure the deformation between the layers of the strata. So by using this one, we can measure up to 1 millimeter accuracy. We can, because different is generally the what you call the deformation will be very small. So we need to measure at a very lowest to what you call the measurable unit. So that is the reason that delimitation, the delimitation of this particular instrument or the measuring indicators is up to an accuracy of 1 millimeter. Okay. Next, the movement between the adjacent anchors is calculated by subtracting the movement of lower anchor from the movement of upper anchor. Because if there is a this one, right? Because the anchors are placed at a different location. Look at here, this is one location, this is second, third, fourth. If I wanted to measure, let us say, this layer versus this layer. So I need to subtract what would be the corresponding deformation here and what would be the corresponding deformation there. If I subtract this one, what is the reading between these two or these two anchoring points, then I will be knowing, at this particular location, after subtracting these two readings, I will be knowing like how much is the deformation between the layers of the strata. So that's what it is. The movement between the adjacent anchors is calculated by subtracting the movement of lower anchor from the movement of upper anchor. However, the bed separation above the top anchor, which is also a reference anchor, is not measurable with this instrument because there's nothing, right? Because it's a kind of relative measurement that we need to do. If the anchor is present here, okay, I cannot measure anything, this one, right? I can measure anything, any deformation between the layers of the strata or in between anchors that are present here. But any deformation on this, because this I need to measure with reference to some other anchor. But there won't be, because this is the last stage of this particular extensometer, right? It's I cannot extend beyond this one. This is the last point of it. So it is very difficult to measure the deformation with respect to this anchor, the last anchoring point. But we can pretty much measure the deformation between the layers using an intermediate anchoring points. So that's what does. However, the beds, see here, the bed separation above the top anchor, which is also a reference anchor, is not measurable with this instrument, because there won't be any, that is only the reference, with that reference only we'll be measuring the movement between the layers of the strata. Okay, this is about the telltale borehole extensiometer, which is one of the device extensively used in underground coal mines. Next, the next one is magnetic ring multi-point borehole extensiometer. So this is not that popular, but still it is being used in the field quite some time. Okay, basically what exactly it is? See, it works based on the principle of, let us say, if any current carrying conductor which passes through any magnetic, what you call the medium, it produces the flux. So the same principle is being used, okay, in measuring the deformation between the layers of the strata. Okay, if you look at here, magnetic ring in this case, right, in case of magnetic ring multi-point borehole extensiometer, it consists of number of what you call the magnetic rings. So these magnetic rings are placed at installing this particular equipment, a vertical borehole is being drilled into the roof, okay, which is of around 38 mm diameter. Then the magnetic rings will be placed at different locations in the overlying layers of the strata, a different location, by using metallic probe. This metallic probe is used to place the what you call the magnetic rings in different locations. The probe will be having a graduated scale. So by using the graduated scale which is attached to the probe, we can measure at what location this particular rings are being placed. Okay, next, after placing these rings in a different locations, then what you call the probe will be moved. Initially, see here, it will be moved. It's a kind of conductor, right? So when it is passing through this one, it will measure the initial reading. When it is passing through this one, what are the flux that generated, which in terms generates the kind of what you call the electricity, okay, that is being what you call the measured. So when the probe will passes through different magnetic what you call the rings, the corresponding magnetic flux generated, it varies. In case of what you call any deformation between the layers of the strata, whatever the earlier reading that we took, okay, and the flux generated earlier, there will be a difference of flux generated between the magnetic rings. So by using the difference of flux that got generated due to movement of overlying strata, the corresponding deformation will be measured. So this is what exactly the principle behind the operation of magnetic ring multi-point borehole extensiometer. Let us see. It works. The magnetic ring multi-point borehole extensiometer, it works on the principle of magnetic flux generated in the magnetic ring anchors whose position is identified to the accuracy of 1 millimeter, because it can measure the deformation up to an accuracy of 1 millimeter with the help of probe connected to the readout unit. A number of magnetic ring anchors are inserted over a guide rope at a predefined horizon, nothing but at predefined locations, either in the roof or inside the pillar, in a 42 mm diameter hole. So the magnetic rings are placed at a required location with the help of a guide rope. Next, a probe is attached with a graduated scale, is inserted through the guide rope. As the probe is nothing but the middle metallic one. Okay, as the probe passes over the magnetic anchor, the induced current generated due to magnetic flux causes the light bulb indicator in the readout unit to glow. So the position of the anchor can be measured from the scales attached to the probe as shown in the figure. Okay, this instrument can be installed up to any depth. Yes, this is what one of the major advantages of this instrument. If you look at telltale borehole extensiometer, we cannot place the instrument up to a greater depth. Whereas in this case, we can use as many magnetic rings as possible, okay, to a greater depth. So this instrument can be installed up to any greater depth, in any direction, in a horizontal hose to measure the pillar dilution. Okay, it also used to measure pillar dilation, and it also used by drilling the holes in a horizontal direction as well as the vertical deformation in the roof by drilling the holes in a vertical direction. See here, or vertically up in the roof to measure the bed separation. Okay. A large number of anchors, typically between 4 and 10. The number of what you call the metallic, magnetic rings that we'll be using is, typically it lies between 4 and 10, 4 to 10. Can be used to monitor bed separation at different locations, the pillar or roof. So this is about the magnetic ring multi-point borehole extensometer. So these are all the different measuring devices, or the deformation measuring devices that we'll be using for effective strata control in mining. Okay, thank you.